Welcome to worship with us today, church. We're so glad that you're here today. We're going to continue looking into God's principles for our finances and how that can set us free and give us peace.
Yes, welcome. We're glad that you're with us this morning. Take a few moments, if you would, and in the comment space below, say hello, say good morning, and also invite those in your family and in your friend groups to come and join in our worship time together.
Lost, he's a way maker. If
Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 28. You may follow along or listen as we read. To you, O Lord, I call, my rock, be not deaf to me, lest if you were silent to me, I become like those who go down to the pit.
Hear the voice of my supplication as I cry to you for help, as I lift up my hands towards your holy sanctuary.
Blessed be the Lord who has heard the voice of my supplications.
The Lord is my strength and shield in whom my heart trusts. So I am helped and my heart exults, and with my song I give thanks to the Lord.
The Lord is the strength of the people, the saving refuge of his anointed.
Oh, save your people and bless your heritage. Be their shepherd and carry them forever.
Amen.
Hi kids, I'm so glad that you're worshiping with us today. So I'm out here on my patio this afternoon, and I've been thinking about all the time we spend wanting things. Wanting the biggest, the best, the newest. What about you? Is there something that you want more than anything else? Like a new video game? Or maybe the most beautiful doll in the whole world? I tell you, when I ask myself what I want right now, it's M&M's. I love M&M's, and I always want to try out the new flavors, the new colors. I saw these at the store the other day. Look at the colors. Man, I saw them and I had to have them. We spend a lot of time wanting, don't we? Wanting the biggest, the best, the newest. Wanting what other people have. Did you know that Jesus said there was only one thing that we should want more than anything else? And that is to be a part of God's kingdom, loving him and loving others. And that when we do that, everything else falls into place. You see, I could take these M&Ms and I could gobble them all up for myself, and all I would have would be an empty cup and probably a tummy ache. But if I take these and share them with someone, wow, that's when the fun really begins. So I'm going to challenge you this week to find something you can share with others. Think about when you're wanting something and about how God wants us to want him and to love him and love others more than anything else, even more than M&M. So God bless you. I hope you have a great week this week. And I can't wait to see you in person. When I do, I'm going to share some M&Ms with you. You take care and stay safe. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Leanne, children, for the message that you bring each Sunday. It's a joy to hear what you have for us. It speaks to all ages of children, from the very youngest to the 70 and 80-somethings. Thank you for sharing that message.
And you know, we have a congregation that shares in so many ways. Pastor
yes.
John and I have been so touched by the ways our congregation is sharing their gifts and their talents. And one of the examples of that was that we had Daryl Renfro. We were in a meeting, an SPRC meeting, and we were talking about coming back to worship among other things. And he said, remind me, I'm going to get the church three, like, walk-up scan thermometers so that you don't have to have a person. You just get to walk up and be scanned. He just did that out of the goodness of his heart, just like that.
It is amazing, people stepping up. We were able to get a trailer for the church and for the food ministry through this district grant. Mike Summers said, hey, I'll go to San Antonio and pick it up. And he went all the way to San Antonio, picks up a trailer, and brings it back to the valley.
6-hour round trip. What a gift, because it meant a staff member didn't have to go. And this morning, earlier today, we had folks come out and play music and direct traffic so that you, the church, could come to receive communion from your pastors. And we couldn't do that without you and without your gifts of yourself and your time and your talents.
There is a spirit of generosity in this congregation that is just amazing. And it's so appreciated and so needed. As we move back to in-person worship in the days and weeks to come, it's going to be even more important. You know, many of you have heard that we've had to make some adjustments to budgets. And so as we face difficulty in some of the financial issues, it's going to be so important for all of us to step up and do and be what God has called us to be as a part of the church. This is our time of offering and tithes. If you would take time to either give online, bring it by the church office, drop it in the lockbox, mail it in, so that the ministries, the many different ministries of this church, can continue to happen and lives are changed. Church, as we come to this time of prayer, let us join our hearts and minds together and lift our prayers before God. Let us pray. God, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. You have blessed us in so many ways. You have given us the gift of salvation. You've given us the gift of your word and your spirit. And by all of those things, you teach us and you guide us and help us to live for you. Lord, we thank you for giving us also the gift of reason that allows us to think and to plan as we look forward to the days to come. And so, Lord, we ask that you would help us to continue to plan and plot as we strive to serve you. Lord, we thank you for giving us all that we need. Help us, Lord, to be content with what you give to us. Help us to be grateful for the gifts of food and clothing, for shelter, for transportation. And Lord, if there are those that need any of those things, may we be your hands and feet to share and to give and to provide for those in our community that are in need. Lord, we thank you for the call that you have placed in our lives. We ask you simply to help us to live out that call in all that we do. May we be a light in the darkness. May we be a source of refreshing for our community as we strive to serve you. This we ask in Christ's name.
And it's in Christ's name that we pray the prayer he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The scripture is taken from Genesis chapter 41. It's when Joseph is speaking to Pharaoh about how to plan for 7 years of famine. This is what he says. Therefore, Pharaoh should find an intelligent and wise man and put him in charge of the entire land of Egypt. Then Pharaoh should appoint supervisors over the land and let them collect 1/5 of all the crops during the 7 good years. Have them gather all the food produced in the good years that are just ahead and bring it to Pharaoh's storehouses. Store it away and guard it so there will be food in the cities. That way there will be enough to eat when the 7 years of famine come to the land of Egypt. Otherwise, this famine will destroy the land. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Earn all you can. Save all you can. Give all you can. That's how John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, he summed up biblical teaching into these 3 tenets: to earn, to save, and to give all we could. And as we find ourselves in the heart of a pandemic, as financial crisis and uncertainty becomes one of the things that's preying on all of our minds, we need God's teaching from the Bible more than ever, and we realize it more than ever. And so last week I talked with you about that first tenet, earn all you can, right? And for many of you, that was like being set free. Some of you have said, oh, I just always felt a little guilty about being successful. And once we realize that we have gifts and we have talents and we have skills and that our work is a calling, it's a way that makes the world better, and it's a way that we can provide for our families, for ourselves, and we shouldn't be ashamed, then we're set free. So I hope you felt that liberation last week. Now this week we're going to get to a cultural tenet, save all you can. I'm here at the bank vault of the old Frost Bank building. And we're going to talk about something that's a little less intuitive for us as Americans, and that is, how is it that we save all we can? Now, in this recent pandemic, I was looking at Forbes magazine, and Forbes magazine said one of the things that makes it so hard is that 78% of Americans live paycheck to paycheck. So think about that for a second. Let that really settle in. That 78% of the people in your neighborhood, 78% of the people that your kids go to school with, 78% of the people who you worship next to,
if they miss one paycheck, are in financial trouble. 78% of Americans cannot miss one paycheck. And what has this, what has COVID done to us? Well, one of the things that every single person I speak to talks about is not just the loneliness, but it's the financial issues, right? The worries, the fears, the being kept up at night, the slowdowns at work, the loss of jobs, the being laid off, like my husband being furloughed, and then the stress of, okay, how do I continue to manage when I don't have the resources I used to? And so you guys, we can't go back and fix things. Although I do find this interesting that usually the savings rate for us as Americans, when you say how much of this are we putting away, right? The savings rate is sometimes negative, which means less than nothing is put away, often hovering around 4%. And in this pandemic, it skyrocketed up to 25%. It's as if we all went, we haven't been doing enough and we need to make up for lost time, and I'm going to try to do it all right now. Well, good. So we realize something. But at the same time, what we need to start with is to begin with saying, okay, so I can't really correct everything I did in the past that I'd like to do differently. I can't fix that. But moving forward, how is it that God would have me steward, right, care for everything that's under, that's in my hands that God has given me? And one of the best ways we do that is we think, okay, it's not just earn all we can, it's also save all we can, right? And the Bible is full. You look at the Proverbs and you look at the Psalms and you look at the Old and New Testament, it's full of encouragements to be careful and deliberate and plan what we're doing with our money, to even save, right? The Proverbs call that wisdom. And one of my favorite scriptures was what was read this morning. It's about Joseph, that Joseph, through this, you probably know the story. He's a youngest son. He has a coat of many colors. He's favored by his father. His brothers get jealous and they beat him up and sell him as a slave. And then over the years, God raises him up to a position of leadership so that when the country of Egypt, where he's been sold as a slave, goes through a famine, Joseph is there to tell the king, we need to use these plentiful years to get us ready for the famine that's on the other side. We need to save, right? He's like, let's save 20% so that we can get through. And because of his good saving, Joseph is able to get not only the nation of Egypt, all of those people, through 7 years of famine, but he's able to get his own family, all of his brothers, to reconcile and then to provide for them as well. And there's a huge value that we have in saving, right? And preparing. And so we are encouraged to save all we can, not just a little bit. And that becomes so important when we're in a financial crisis. Every institution, right? Every business, every worker, every family has told me that this has really tightened the screws on you financially. No one has said, oh, you know, I'm breezing through this, right? This is a trying time. And when we're stressed out, when we feel like we're on the edge of a knife and finances are keeping us up at night, well, then we need to turn to God and say, okay, God, what is it that you say that would give me peace? Because God's desire for us isn't that we be stressed out and that we be up at night, right? But that we be able, like Joseph did, to not only provide for the people under our care, but to be able to even extend that blessing, right? Even further. And so think about it like this. The first two tenets, right? Sometimes when you're in financial trouble, it feels like you're in a room that is filling up with water and you have this much breathing room and your feet are off the ground and you're treading water and the space is getting smaller and smaller and smaller. And so we have the biblical teaching that starts with, okay, so first you see your job as your calling and you earn all you can, right? So that raises the ceiling. And then you don't just stop there, you save all you can. And so that's lowering the water level, pushing it down until you're not treading water, you're standing on firm ground and you've got a room full of air where you can breathe. That's God's dream for all of us financially, is that space to be free, to breathe, to be generous, right? To not worry, to take our focus off of the money and making it happen and the finances and the fears and say, you know what, that's taken care of. And so now I can think about you and my family and the people around me. God, you know, this is so good. So how is it, friends? See, what happens with Americans, since we're good at the earning thing, is most of the time if you earn a little bit more, you spend a little bit more, right? So you're losing your breathing room in that. And studies even show, you probably heard these, that 70% of the folks who win the lottery, are broke within a couple of years. And so we are not going to solve our financial problems just by earning more. Because as we earn more, well, then we spend more. Unless we listen to God's biblical teaching and say, okay, so there's also a biblical principle that we save all we can. And then we find that breathing room and that freedom. So how is it in a society that says if you earn more, then you spend more and you get more and you get, how is it that we follow God's advice instead? Well, the first thing that I want us to do is to cultivate contentment. The 10th commandment talks about contentment. It's all about contentment. It says, you must not covet your neighbor's house. You must not covet your neighbor's wife, male or female servant, ox or donkey or anything else that belongs to your neighbor. And I found we don't talk very much about the 10th commandment. More's the pity, y'all. Because covetousness, right? That, ooh, that's a really nice oxen. Or man, I wish I was married to that person. They seem like an amazing, or I wish that that was my employee. Whenever we stop looking at God, right? And we start looking at the good things that other people have. We stop looking at what's in our hands and we start looking with green-eyed envy at, well, what do they have over there? Our heart goes down the wrong trail. And when we live according to the 10th commandment, it shuts down covetousness, right? It anchors our hearts into the bedrock of Jesus' unchanging love for us. Instead of maybe that oxen will make me happy, it's I find my happiness in the Lord. Instead of maybe being with that person or maybe having that thing, it's, oh, look at the good that God has placed in my hands. And so the first way we save all we can is we work to cultivate our contentment by putting our eyes on God and on the good things that God has placed in our hands and deciding we're not going to look with envy at the others, right? And this is what, I love this verse here, what Paul says about contentment. Godliness, this is from 1 Timothy 6, godliness with contentment is great wealth. Godliness with contentment is great wealth. So begin with contentment. And then after you have, and you'll just have to reaffirm that over and over because there's always an ad or there's somebody gets a new toy or there's something that you go, oh, I want that. And then as soon as you do, you say, no, wait a minute. Refocus my heart on God, anchor it in God's love and provision, anchor it in the good things that are already in my hands. And that'll shut down the wanting so that you can save more. And then the next thing to do is just make a plan. Paul talks about this too. He tells the Corinthians, on the first day of each week, you should each put aside a portion of the money you've earned. Don't wait until I get there and try to collect it all at once. And now he's talking about being generous, which we'll get to. But it holds, this principle holds for our savings as well. That a lot of times we're trying to get to the end of the month and use whatever's left over for savings. Just like Paul says, don't do that, it won't work. And we found that it doesn't work, right? So the way that God would have us do it is to make a plan and then to live by it and to do those things first. Generosity is something that comes first, and so is savings. So I encourage you right now, because we're not worshiping in church, right? When the service is over, take a deep breath and get your favorite beverage. And if you're married, grab your spouse. And I want you to open up your financial software, okay? I want you to give the kids their favorite movie or their favorite cartoon. And y'all, you, if you're married or alone or with your spouse, you sit and you look at your finances. And look at what you're earning. Okay, that's your ceiling. What are you bringing in every month? Then look at what you're spending, right? And that's your water level. And you may already know it feels like you're drowning, right? Or you may say, oh, it's right here, it's not bad. But what you're trying to do is to get that water level as low as possible, right? So that you have as much breathing room as you possibly can. And some of the ways we're gonna do that, first of all, the contentment, right? That'll help. The second thing is just looking and saying, okay, what are the things that I could stop doing or I could do more cheaply? You know, if you're like me, there's some magazine subscriptions or there's some online subscriptions that you could probably go without and not even really miss. I mean, how many streaming services do we really need for music or for TV or whatever? So you could get rid of some of those right off the bat. You could cut some subscriptions. There's some things you could probably do a little bit more cheaply. Like if you have a book you want to read, you could, instead of buying it, go get it from the library. Go read it online from the library. Instead of buying a brand new car, you could get a used car. There's probably some things that you could get onto Craigslist, or you could get onto a swap, or you could get onto some kind of a selling site and sell to make a little bit of money. But get really creative and get really innovative with this and make the space as big as possible. Because then what you can do is you can make a plan and say, okay, so it's pretty good wisdom financially to save 10 to 15% of what you make. Let's start saving for our kids' college. Let's start saving for a new house or a new car. Or, you know, if you've already got the basics, then let's save for that boat we've been wanting or whatever it is, right? If you need some help with any of this, go online to daveramsey.com, because that's some of the best teaching I've found from a Christian and a Wesleyan point of view on how it is that we can live according to God's principles. Just some really practical budgeting tools for you and for your family. So once we do this, once we earn all we can, right, using the gifts and the skills that God has given us and seeing our work as a calling, and then we save all we can, not just a little bit, but like all we can, then we have this amazing space open up in our lives. The space that used to be filled with stress about money and fear and sleepless nights, suddenly we're in this wide open space. And we can breathe, and we can think about things other than money. And best of all, we can get to the last part, the fun part, give all you can. That's what we'll talk about next week. At church, we talked this morning about contentment and how that can change our financial well-being and how it can reshape our hearts and help us focus on God. But I also realize that we're in this season where we are realizing not just that we covet that oxen or that donkey or that person's this or that, but we long for what used to be. It's almost like we're coveting what is in the past. And one of the things that the Lord would have us do is refocus our hearts and be content with what is before us, even when what is before us is something hard. And so Pastor John and I just wanted to be out here with the kids who always live in the moment, who always, their focus is always on right what they're doing, so that we could recenter our hearts on where we are today. That if you're watching on Sunday morning, perhaps you took communion together with us in the drive-thru at the church. That we are still united in worship together, even when we're at a distance here. And that no matter where we're taking the Lord's Supper, we are in the presence of God, and that brings us great contentment. So we remember that on the night he gave himself up for us, Jesus took the juice and the bread. He broke the bread. He held out the juice. He thanked God, and he shared it with his followers. And he invited them to eat and to drink and told them that as they did that, they should remember him. So friends, with whatever elements that you have, the bread and the juice, whatever elements you gathered, may you eat and drink in contentment at the table of the Lord, wherever you are, and in remembrance of Jesus, our Savior. Let's pray. God, I pray you would pour out your Holy Spirit over each of us, near and far, over the elements on our tables and in our homes and in our hands, the bread and the juice, that those elements would be for us your body and your blood, and that as they enter our body, you would be bringing us your Holy Spirit, your healing, your power, so that we would be transformed from the inside, so that everywhere we go, we would be witnesses and models of your love and your compassion for us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So, John, this is the body of Christ and the blood of Christ given for you. Yeah. Oh, thank you. These are the little communion things we're using with you.
The bread.
Uh-huh. Amen. You hold this, I'll open it for you.
Okay.
This is a challenge. The bread. And your cup. Given for you.
Thanks be to God.
Through the eyes of innocence, a soul.
as you go out today, as you go out to look at the shape of the finances, may God go with you. May he enliven your mind. May he grace your heart. May he guide you. Most of all, may Jesus give you that deep contentment, that is ours as we anchor our lives in Jesus, and then we move forward with God's direction. Amen.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I'll follow.